Narcissists are not into slow people or unintelligent people or unattractive people. So if you have found yourself with a narcissist, chances are you're probably attractive as well as intelligent. And probably stronger than you thought, because narcissists love a challenge.
Narcissists want someone who has characteristics maybe they don't have, or who owns certain qualities or certain things that they want. Maybe that person has certain talents that the narcissist admires, or that person has certain character traits that the narcissist wants or thinks that other people want. Or maybe that person is really, really good looking and the narcissist feels like they could be some sort of trophy. Or maybe that person's really strong-willed and they really know what they want in life and they have all the things happening that are moving them in that direction.
They're someone who, in general, tend to impress people they meet. They really want to kind of stand in that person's light. Narcissists themselves are naturally dark people, as in they don't have this inner light to shine out and share with the world. And so what do they want? They want to consume the light that you have.
Personally, I think that narcissists who meet amazing people like you and who manage to get you under control, who manage to manipulate you and gaslight you and make you think you're not good enough or make you think you're crazy or whatever it is they're trying to make you think, they see you as a challenge, you see. They feel more accomplished if they're able to actually stop you from feeling good about yourself, from feeling like you are strong-willed. And yet, of course, on the flip side of that, they're not as attracted to you when you are broken. So what I mean is they might see you like a wild horse that needs to be tamed and broken. And that might be very attractive to them. But once they actually do tame and break you, suddenly they're bored with you. They're done. Sound familiar?
It's because we don't believe that we are good enough or that we are worth anything that they are able to get to us. It's what makes us vulnerable to narcissists. When a narcissist is trying to choose a victim, they're looking for someone who is going to be dependable, someone who's going to always be ready to help them anytime they need it. So people who are prime choice victims, they are people who tend to be joiners or helpers. You know, if they see somebody in pain, they want to help that person. And that's unfortunately something that an empath naturally does. When you're an empath, you naturally want to help anyone that you see who needs help. So a narcissist picks up on that.
There are 12 common behaviors that spouses and partners of narcissists tend to report. They are as follows. Number one, it feels like you're the one doing most of the work in the relationship. Number two, your partner does things to sort of sabotage the relationship and prevent it from moving forward, but they don't want to let you go either. Number three, your partner has episodes of excessive and often unjustified anger, sometimes even infidelity, and he or she somehow makes it all your fault. Number four, the relationship is mostly focused around your partner's interests and activities, and when it's not, there will be an ugly outburst or argument. Number five, you feel controlled or manipulated by your partner's moods to the point that you might feel like you're walking on eggshells all the time, like you're a servant to the narcissist's whims. Number six, you might find yourself covering up, explaining, or apologizing for their behavior. Number seven, your partner might make one-sided decisions that impact your safety and well-being. Number eight, you might feel unsafe because of some of the actions that your partner takes. Number nine, your partner will refuse to see your good intentions, always blaming you for every situation, always making you admit you're wrong, even when that's not the case. Number 10, you sometimes find yourself desperately trying to remember the times when your partner showed love for you, when they acted like you could do no wrong, as is often the case in the early parts of the relationship when the love bombing is happening. Number 11, you feel emotionally exhausted, often completely drained by how hard you have to work to make or keep your partner happy. And number 12, your partner might have a history of troubled relationships and/or addictions.
Another thing that we are that might shock you is a lot of us have a little bit of perfectionism in us. And now we might not have perfect this or perfect that, but there's something about us that is perfectionistic. Our perfectionism falls where we need to help people in a perfect way. So we might often keep kind of a low profile. We're kind of the behind the scenes people. And a lot of times we don't want to overshadow our friends and colleagues. We want to lift them up. We don't want to stand in front of them. They want someone who will take personal responsibility for everything, even things they didn't do, and someone who will work really hard for them. So they're looking for someone to be responsible, hard worker, someone who will always comply with whatever assignment they get from the narcissist. So they might test you in little ways. Like they might be like, oh, here's $20, go to the store and get me this, that, or the other thing. And if you go, oh, don't worry about it, I got it. Number one, you pass the little narcissist test because you're willing to spend your own money. Number two, you don't even think about the fact that they just ask you to go to the store when you just told them you worked all day and your back hurts. You know what I'm saying? So that kind of stuff. And then the last quality that I'm going to share with you today is kind of surprising, but it's true. And it is above average intelligence. Yeah, they look for the smart people. How about that? And on the same token, they look for good-looking people.
Between the gaslighting, the love bombing, and the flying monkeys, you end up forgetting your own identity as you desperately try to become the version of yourself that might make the narcissist happy. But even if you manage to completely change and morph yourself into the narcissist's idea of the imagined perfect person, it never matters. Here's a painful truth for you, and I hope you take it in the spirit in which it is intended. You will never be enough for a narcissist. It's a harsh reality that we all have to understand. But when it comes to the narcissist and their perception of you, you can never be enough. Even if you completely focus every bit of your energy on that person, he or she will always look somewhere else for something else, anything to increase their own supply of attention. No matter how amazing you are, and you are amazing, it will never be enough for a narcissist because it's never been about you. Don't let yourself be confused here. It is not you. You are not the problem. It's absolutely not about you. It's about the way the narcissist's convoluted mind works. And you can't take personal responsibility for the broken person you're dealing with. You just have to find a way to self-confidence and peace outside of the narcissist. The fact is that since the narcissist is so personally broken on the inside, nobody on earth is ever going to fill the endless hole of need the narcissist carries around. At least not for long. There are so many manipulation tactics that most narcissists have in common that most of their victims say reading about the abuse that they've suffered can feel like reading their own stories, even when it's my story or your story. Their tactics are underhanded and sneaky and often undetectable. And yet, these tactics can sometimes be so definable that even a child can learn to recognize them.
Bottom line, whatever it is that the narcissist likes about you, they will inevitably try to destroy that thing in you. So maybe you have a really great career and you're successful and your life is awesome and the narcissist wants in on that. And yet somehow during the course of your relationship, the narcissist manages to destroy or at least slow down your career. Or maybe you're someone who has a public persona and they want to be with you on the red carpet everywhere you go. And suddenly they start some kind of drama that causes your career to go down the tubes. Maybe they're jealous that you have a really good relationship with someone in your family, your whole family. They want to be part of it. And yet, as you take them to family events and do all these things, they're constantly undermining and undercutting. And before you know it, you're estranged from your family. Not only do narcissists want to isolate you in order to control you, but they want to destroy the things in your life that are good. Because people with narcissistic personality disorder tend to see you and other people in their lives as extensions of themselves, they are always looking for people who are one step above them or 10 steps above them. And not only does that make them feel like they've conquered something by getting your attention and getting you to be with them or spend time with them, but it also sort of makes them feel as though they have accomplished what you have accomplished. Number two, the narcissist looks for someone who validates them, someone who listens to their feelings, listens to what they have to say, and tells them, honey, you're so right. I totally get it.
This is the person who walks around saying yes to the narcissist. Yes, you're amazing. Yes, you have valid feelings. Yes, I believe what you say. Yes, you seem real to me. This person will overlook their flaws. This person will basically hold them up on a pedestal and tell them how great they are. Sometimes this person is their mother or their father. Sometimes this person is a boss or a friend, and sometimes it's a spouse or a partner.
This person will find all the things that are right with the narcissist and lift those things up. And any flaws the narcissist has, this person will minimize and sort of shove aside in order to make the narcissist feel good. I think I was this type of person, and I still am up to a point.
And we think, maybe I can help that person, or maybe it'll get better, or maybe people change, or maybe they're just insecure because we're not committed yet. And then you allow that person to stay in your life. That's one possibility.
I always felt like I needed to help people in my life, whether they were my friends or family members or partners, to feel better about themselves. And so it was my mission in each relationship to lift up that person and make them feel better about themselves. And when that's done, a lot of times a narcissist will dump you and walk away, or they'll use you for supply because you validate them so well. Does that ring true for you?
Most empaths are always going to do their very best to try to hold up everyone else's self-esteem. And this is why narcissists are very attracted to this nurturer type.
And number three is kind of similar to number two, but it's a little different. This is someone whose sole purpose in the narcissist's mind will make them feel good about themselves. Now, this could be a combination of one and two. This could be somebody who looks really good and validates everything they say and feel. Or it's someone who just lifts them up for who they are.
This is someone who is always doing their very best to make everyone around them feel amazing. They might help the narcissist feel better about him or herself by constantly issuing compliments to them, constantly telling them how great they are, kind of picking them up whenever they're sad. This is the type of person who's going to react quickly and swiftly to any extreme emotion expressed by a narcissist, and they're going to do their very best to hold them up so they don't fall into their own pit of self-hate, self-loathing.
This person will give them lots of compliments and lots of shows of affection, maybe a public display of affection, or maybe, you know, they'll Facebook call them out for being amazing or whatever it is. This person is all about not just privately lifting this person up, but also publicly and making that person feel like $1 million. And then finally, number four, which we've kind of already touched on, the person who has stuff going on in the positive for them.
It's a person who is perfect in every way.
Whether this is someone who is strong family relationships or great career, or someone who is a model and they're walking the runway, this is a person that the narcissist feels is impressive to them in some way. So it's someone who they almost feel like they have to reach up to get. And if we're being honest, all four of these people on some level are someone the narcissist has to reach up to get.
And as soon as that narcissist gets their hooks into someone and recognizes that that person is in fact only human, the idealization phase ends, and boom, they find themselves being devalued and discarded in sometimes cycles, and sometimes the permanent discard comes, but usually there's some hoovering involved.
Because even the narcissist who has everything, even a narcissist who is wealthy financially and has everything going on for them, they very often miss the important things in life. They don't have any real connections with people. They don't have any real friends or people they can count on because they have alienated everyone, or because the people who are in their lives are just scared of them and they're only doing what they do in order to avoid the narcissistic rage coming their way. We already know that narcissists have a lot of negative personality qualities. We already know that they want something that doesn't exist. I talked in a previous video about how narcissists seem to want a unicorn. But in addition to that, they have these outrageous expectations that are unrealistic for partners and family members, friends, coworkers, anyone who's going to be close to them.
Grab a pen and a piece of paper if you have a minute. Pause the video. I'll wait. So my first question for you is, do you have clear boundaries in place? Do you have deal breakers in place that would cause you to immediately end a relationship with someone? For example, in my life, I have three basic deal breakers, and they are: don't physically hit me, don't emotionally hit me — those are really both together — don't abuse me, don't hurt my children in any way, and don't cheat on me. Those are my deal breakers. You've got to have boundaries and deal breakers in place if you're going to be in any sort of healthy relationship. Another question: have you ever left a relationship because that person was insensitive or didn't care about your feelings, or because they were too selfish? Have you? Ask yourself that question. Let's say the relationship started out great, and let's say that over time it goes downhill. Would you leave the relationship, or would you stay in the relationship with hopes that it would get better? Another question: do you allow people to devalue you or tear you down emotionally? Do you allow people to make you feel bad about yourself? Have you ever found yourself making excuses for someone else's bad behavior? So if they were rude to you, do you just go, well, they had a hard day? Or do you tolerate any sort of verbal abuse at all? making excuses for their behavior in the process, any sort of abuse. If someone abuses you or crosses your boundaries or your deal breakers, do you leave immediately or do you stick around and try to fix it? These are important questions to ask yourself, and here's why. If you value yourself, you will behave in ways that will show the world and any narcissist or potential connection that you will not tolerate certain things. So if you go into the world with an open mind and an open heart, but with those deal breakers in place, with those boundaries in place, it's very possible that you can end up finding a decent person. My point is, you got to raise your standards. You can't tolerate things like abuse. You can't tolerate even some of the smaller things, like someone who's just a little selfish. A little selfish is one thing. Excessively selfish with a lack of empathy is a toxic person. And you can't let toxic people be part of your inner circle. Share your thoughts, share your ideas, share your experiences in the comment section below. And let's talk about it. As always, thank you so much for being a part of my day and a part of my life. And hey, thanks for letting me be a part of yours. It really does mean a lot to me. Now, before I go, make sure you take a look at the videos I'm going to leave for you right there and right there. And while you're here, hit that subscribe button right over there so we can stay connected and continue on this healing journey together. I'll see you soon.